Today, we are going to build a fully functional high-speed Tron light cycle game using nothing but raw C++. No Unity, no Unreal Engine, no Godot, no graphics libraries. We are going to speak directly to the Windows console. We are going to render the scene, handle real-time input, and even ride an AI opponent that tries to outsmart you. First, we need to lay the foundation. By default, a command prompt window is designed for text. It scrolls, it wraps, and it has a blinking cursor. None of that works for a game. We need to lock this environment down. We start by including Windows Edge. This header file is massive. It gives us access to the Windows API, allowing us to talk to the operating system. Let's look at the setup console function. The most important variable here is HOUT, which stands for handle to output. In Windows programming, a handle is like a unique ID card. Windows manages hundreds of windows. This handle tells the OS, hey, I want to modify this specific console window. We then define two different coordinate types, chord and small rect. Chord sets the size of the screen buffer. Think of it as a total amount of paper in typewriter. Small rect sets the size of the window viewport. This is the physical frame you see on your monitor. By setting them to the exact same size, we disable scroll bars. Finally, look at this line with set window long. We are performing a bitwise operation here. We get the current window style flags, and we use the AND NOT operator to strip away the WS sizebox flag. This literally tells Windows, draw the window, but do not draw the border that allows resizing. This ensures the player can't accidentally drag the window and break our rendering grid. This likely won't work inside your IDE or Windows PowerShell, but if you run it in a classical command prompt, it should. Now let's build the engine. This is the most complex part, so stick with me. If you draw directly to the screen using Cout, the user sees us drawing. They see the characters appear one by one. This looks terrible. We need double buffering. Imagine you have two canvases. One is on the wall, the screen, and one is hidden in the back room. The memory buffer. We paint the entire scene on the hidden canvas, and when we are done, we instantly swap them. The user never sees the painting process, only the finished result. In code, our hidden canvas is a std unique pointer array of char info struct. We use unique pointer because it is a smart pointer. It automatically cleans up the memory when the variable is not needed anymore. Notice how we access the pixels. Our screen is 2D. X and Y, but computer memory is one-dimensional, a long straight line. To find a specific pixel, we use the formula Y times width plus X. This skips over Y number of rows to find the correct spot. Console characters are rectangular, about twice as tall as they are wide. If we draw a single character, our pixels look like skinny rectangles. To fix this, for every logical coordinate in the game, we draw two characters side by side on the screen. This visual trick makes our game look like it's made of perfect square blocks. Almost perfect. We have a rendering engine, so let's make it interactive. In a standard C++ program, you use cin variable to get input. But cin is blocking. It holds the entire thread until you press enter. That would kill our game loop. We need non-blocking input-output. We use this from the con.io library. This function returns true immediately if key is waiting in the buffer and false if it isn't. It never pauses the program. If a key is pressed, we use getChar to grab the character code. I'm also introducing an enum class for direction. Using an enum up, down, left, right is much safer and easier to read than using magic numbers like 0, 1, 2, 3. Look at the input logic closely. If C is equal to W and direction is not down, this is critical. In Tron, if you are moving down and you press W to go up, you would instantly collide with your own body and die. We explicitly forbid 180 degree turns here. We didn't do anything like this in our old Snake project. Looking back, we could Dorito it using the knowledge we have now about better console output handling. We have a movement, but we don't have a game yet because we have no enemy and we can't crash. Beginners often try to check collisions by reading the screen pixels, asking, is the pixel at 1010 green? This is bad practice. You should never mix your graphics with your logic if it's not absolutely necessary, like for pixel precise collisions. Instead, we create a logical grid. This is a std vector of characters representing the game world. The good thing is that because we are keeping visuals separate, we can easily change them later without touching the logic. We can go even a step further and say that if we wanted to make it in graphics mode instead of text mode, using real sprites, we could keep literally all the logic in place and work only on that. So to make this work, we have to bridge the two different worlds. The logic world, where the math happens, and the render world, where the player sees. This is where our constants become critical. We have grid W, grid H. These define the actual playable area. Our vector of character size is grid W times grid H. When the AI calculates a path, it only cares about this 56 times 26 grid. It doesn't know what a pixel or color is. Next, we have offset for X, offset for Y, and screen width and height using the constants from before. This calculates the size of the physical console window. Notice the formula, grid width times 2. Console characters are tall and narrow. It is approximately 1:2 ratio. So to make the square look like a visual square, we use two horizontal screen characters for every one logical grid cell. Offset X and Y create a nice blank margin around the game board. We call it padding. It's important so the action doesn't hug the edge of the window. We are going to specify a bunch of colors as well. Remember that these flags control certain bits, which allows us to be creative even in text mode. Let's add new loop and create variable running for it. Every single frame defined by FPS, which is 20 for us, we perform the following cycle. We take the player's current logical position and mark it in our vector grid by number 1. This leaves a permanent rel in the memory. Before moving the player, we calculate the coordinate that they are about to enter. We check that index in our vector. If it's nothing, space, the move is valid. If it's 1, or later 2, we are out of bounds. And crash. The game ends. To keep our code clean, we use lambda function. This is a small local helper function. By using the capture group ampersand, it gains instant access to our grid width and grid height, without us having to pass them as clumsy arguments. It allows us to write readable code like if collision or next position right inside our main loop. Also, let me add a short delay if collision happens just outside of our running loop. Next, we draw the arena. We loop through the width and height to place our border blocks. Notice that we aren't using STDC out here again. We are writing directly to the background buffer we created earlier. For the trails, we iterate over our entire logical grid. If the code sees 1, it paints a trail block. This is where our separation of concerns pays off. The rendering code simply reads the grid state and visualizes it. It doesn't need to know how the trail got there. Finally, we draw the player's current position, the head, in a brighter color so it stands out. But wait, look at the function we are using, draw game char. This is a wrapper we wrote around the raw draw char function. Why the separation? Draw char works in a screen coordinates, raw pixels like 0, 1, 2. Draw game char works in game coordinates. It automatically handles the aspect ratio correction, stretching one game tile into two screen characters, and adds the offset margins. This lets us think in a simple grid numbers like 10, 10, while the function handles the messy screen math for us. Finally, we need an opponent. We want an AI that is smart enough to survive, but simple enough to write in a few lines of code. We use look-ahead strategy. Every frame, the AI asks, if I keep moving forward, will I die? It calculates the coordinates of the next step. It checks the grid vector. If the spot is safe, it keeps going with a small random chance to turn and just to be unpredictable. If the spot is blocked, it enters panic mode. In panic mode, the AI generates a list of all four possible directions. It uses shuffle to randomize this list, and this is crucial. If it didn't shuffle, the AI would always turn up first, making it boring. After shuffling, it tests each direction. The first one that is safe, it takes. This creates an illusion of intelligence. It looks like the AI is reacting to you, but really it's just trying not to die. So we introduce the second direction variable, d2, and a new function called AIChoose. First, it defines what a valid move is, using a local lambda. A move is valid only if the target cell is inside the grid boundaries and is currently empty space. The logic follows a priority system. First, the AI prefers to keep going straight. We check valid or current. If the path ahead is clear, there is a 90% chance it just keeps moving forward. This makes the AI behavior predictable and stable rather than jittery. But what if the path is blocked or it hits that 10% random chance to turn? Here is the list of our all four possible directions, up, down, left, right, and a random shuffle. The AI then tests each direction one by one. The first valid direction it finds, it takes. Back in our game loop, we apply this logic. We ask the AI to choose its next move, mark its current position with a 2 to leave a trail, and then execute the move for both players in the same time using our helper lambda. Finally, we update the render loop to draw the red trail for the AI whenever it sees a 2 in the grid, and of course, draw the AI's current head position. And now, we have a race. We are going to add few last touches handling end of the game. Inside our game loop, we are constantly checking for collisions. If player 1 hits a wall or trail, we flag P1 lost as true. Same for AI, P2 lost becomes true. If anyone crashes, we stop the game loop immediately. Now, we enter the end game phase. First, we wipe the screen clean using Ranger's fill. We want a blank canvas for our victory message, removing the chaos of the finished game. Next, we determine the outcome. There is a specific edge case here. If both players crash in the exact same frame, we must handle it as a draw. Otherwise, we check who crashed to decide if the AI won or if the player won, setting the text and color accordingly, based on their colors, of course. To display this message, we want it perfectly centered. We calculate the starting X position by taking the center of the screen width /2, and subtracting half the length of our text string. This ensures the text sits right in the middle of the monitor. We loop through the string and draw it character by character. Notice we use draw char here, the draw screen function, because we aren't snapping this text to the game grid. We want pixel perfect alignment. Finally, we push this buffer to the console and pause the thread for 2.5 seconds. This gives the player a moment to celebrate or cry before the loop restarts and new match begins. Just for cleaner visual, we update head drawing only if collision didn't happen yet. We are done. Step by step, we built another movie-based C++ project. Let me know in the comments if you would like to see your favorite movie turned into a programming exercise. Until then, have a great time. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to subscribe if you want to see more in the future. Ciao!